start speaking, I'll record it, sir.
Yeah.
Pooja, can you please confirm if it is live on YouTube?
It is live. We can start.
Thank you so much. And can you please also confirm if my screen is visible to you all?
Yes, it is.
Yes, it's visible.
Yes, so we'll start. A very good evening, a very warm welcome. Myself, Aishwarya Nair, welcome you all on behalf of the pharma community for today's session on COVID-19 pathophysiology, approach to treatment and vaccination. I'm thankful to all the participants from all over the country who have taken out their valuable time and are attending this evening talk. PharmD community has been created with a charter to provide free webinars by doctors and PharmD doctors. We conduct this webinar solely for the purpose of pursuing interests, facilitate and foster awareness and education in our chosen field of pharmacotherapeutics. Organizing this event wouldn't have been possible without the wholehearted support of my core committee members. Thanks to Kuldeep, Pooja, Vaishnavi, and Yamini for their support. It's my pleasure to release the flyer of our next webinar. The registration link will be posted in the chat box for both Zoom and YouTube. So we have one upcoming on 26th of September, and the second one is on 28th of September. The link for both will be posted in the chat box towards the later half of the session after the Q&A. I'm thankful to our speaker for today, Dr. Jacob Thomas, who is one of India's eminent diabetologists. I'll hand over the session to my teammate, Yamini, to introduce our speaker for today evening. Over to you, Yamini.
Thank you, Aishwarya. We are glad to have today with us Dr. Jacob Thomas, sir, for this evening talk. Dr. Jacob Thomas, sir, has completed his MBBS from SAGE GS Medical College, KEM Hospital, Mumbai, in 1992. Sir has completed MD Medicine and DNB Medicine from Grant Medical College, Sir JJ Group of Hospitals, Mumbai. Dr. Jacob Thomas, sir, has received all-round training in all specialties, including endocrinology, infectious diseases, immunocompromised diseases, cardiac care, and intensive cardiac care unit. Sir's main interest lies in lifestyle diseases, diabetes, and its complications. Sir is also one of the eminent speakers in many national and international conferences. Currently, Sir is practicing as a consultant physician at Karuna Hospital, Mumbai, and Dr. Jacob's Advanced Diabetes Care Center, Mumbai. With this brief introduction, I would now request Sir to please take over the session. Over to you, Sir.
Yeah. So can I share my screen?
Yes, sir. Sir, stop sharing.
Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
My screen visible? Yeah. Welcome to all of you for this session on COVID-19. We're going to discuss the pathophysiology and approach to treatment and vaccination. And in doing so, I would like to take you all through the entire spectrum of what COVID is all about and what kind of changes that have occurred over the last 4-5 months in terms of our understanding the COVID pathophysiology and also the changes in the treatment that has come about. We'll try to steer clear of any controversies and try to see what hard evidence tells us and try to come to a reasonable understanding of this topic. So when a species population grows unchecked, nature finds some way to limit the population. So as you know, when in a jungle, if the deer population increases, then the lions get a lot of things to feed and therefore they feed on the deer and the deer population comes down. Same way, these kind of so-called natural breaks on human population had not taken place and the human population kept on increasing unchecked. And We thought that nature will not find a way to limit our population, but nature does find a way. Climatic change, etc., is taking place, which is threatening to destroy the human civilization. And one of the ways in which nature will check us is through this periodic pandemics, which we are facing right now. And that is this COVID-19 pandemic that we are facing. Did we have warnings before? Yes, in 2002 and 2003, there was SARS-CoV-1. That virus was similar to coronavirus 2, which we are seeing right now. It affected a few countries in the world. And you know, the research was going on to try and find a vaccine for this SARS-CoV-1, but it suddenly just disappeared. You know, the virus just suddenly disappeared. The pandemic just settled down in spite of the fact that no vaccine had come into the market or vaccines were not given at all. And therefore the research on these vaccination also stopped at 2002, 2003 when the pandemic dies down. One more warning we got in 2012, and that was the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, MERS, as we know, which happened in 2012. It originated from camels in the Gulf country, probably in Saudi Arabia, and it spread to a few countries, namely South Korea, for example, and a few other countries in the world. But that epidemic, that pandemic also, you know, suddenly died down. And the world just forgot about it. And 10 years later, or 8 years later now in 2020, we have this novel coronavirus, which is called SARS-CoV-2. And the disease that it causes is called COVID, or coronavirus infectious disease. So let us see a bit about the structure of the coronavirus. And if you see this coronavirus, you can see here that there is a single-stranded RNA molecule, which is present inside a lipid bilayer. So this red coating that you see is a lipid bilayer. And on the surface, there are many spike proteins. So there are a lot of spikes on the surface. And that spikes looks like a crown, and that is why the name corona has come. So this is the coronavirus. It is basically an RNA virus. And we know that there are spikes on the surface, and one of the spike on the surface, or few of the spikes on the surface, recognizes a receptor in the human body, which is called the ACE2 receptor. And through these spike proteins, they attach to the ACE2 receptors, and that's how the virus enters the human body. Now, these ACE2 receptors, where are they present? They are present in the, you know, nasopharynx, the posterior part of the nose. It's present in the pharynx, and it's also present in the eyes. And therefore, the coronavirus can enter the human body through the nasal mucosa, that is the posterior nasal mucosa, the pharynx, and also through the eyes. Now, you would know that the symptom of COVID is mainly cough and throat pain and throat inflammation. But hardly ever do any of the COVID patients get rhinitis. That's because the rhinitis involves the anterior part of the nasal cavity. And in the anterior part of the nasal cavity, there are no ACE receptors. So when the virus enters through the nose, it just goes through the posterior nasopharynx. And that is why we always get a throat pain and throat inflammation, and we do not get a rhinitis. In fact, if somebody sneezes, we think that he probably does not have a COVID infection at all. And he could be having some other kind of, you know, allergic or influenza-related rhinitis. And these ACE2 receptors, the spike protein attaches to the ACE2 receptors, and then the RNA enters the nasal cells or the pharyngeal cells, and there it multiplies. And after it multiplies, the cell bursts. And when it bursts, it starts infecting the other cells. And very soon the virus enters through the bronchus into the lungs. And in the lungs, there are receptors in the type 2 alveolar cells. And that type 2 alveolar cells is where the virus would enter and start causing a pneumonia-like presentation. What is the incubation period? The incubation period is around 4 to 8 days, but it's very variable. In some cases, as early as 2 days after exposure, the symptom starts. Or in some cases, it can be delayed by more than 15 to 20 days also. Now, primarily the symptoms, as you all probably must be aware of, it starts in the throat in the form of cough and throat pain and some sticky phlegm that the patient gets, sticky mucoid expectoration that the patient might get. The expectoration itself is very, very less. Most of the COVID patient does not expectorate, but they get a very thick kind of a secretion, which they are unable to bring out. That's what they say. And then the symptoms proceeds on to the lungs, and therefore the lungs starts getting involved. And there are what is called ground glass opacities in the lung. The histologically, what you see is alveolitis. And that alveolitis causes the picture of ground glass opacity. And it starts probably anywhere in the lungs. It can start in the base of the lung or in the apex or anywhere in the lungs. And these opacities keep on increasing during the course of the illness. So the course of the illness is that first, the symptom onset would probably come in the throat. That would be the day one of infection. And through over 8 to 12 days, these symptoms will keep on worsening. The COVID infection will enter the lungs and will cause a pneumonitis or a pneumonia-like picture. And therefore, the patient, after 8 or 9 days, and in some cases earlier, they might get some symptoms of breathlessness. And if you check the saturation, at this time, the saturation might be a little low. And that low saturation is what progressively worsens during the course of the illness. And in a small proportion of the cases, that can lead to a severe ARDS, and the patient may have to go on a ventilator, etc. But it does not stop in the lungs itself. Although primarily the manifestation is pulmonary, the infection will not stop in the lung. It can spread to other organs of the body, and therefore it can spread to the liver, the intestines, the pancreas, the heart, and the brain also. And after about 12, 13 days, most of the cases, resolution of symptoms starts, and therefore the breathlessness settles down, and the patient starts to recover. But in a small proportion of cases, what is called a cytokine storm sets in, and that cytokine storm causes much severe worsening of symptoms and progressive damage to the lung, leading to a severe ARDS, and the patient might have to go on to a non-invasive or an invasive ventilator. Now in the lung, as I told you, there is worsening ARDS. The saturations will keep on decreasing as the days of infection progresses. So mind you that the infection, the course of the illness is about 12 to 15 days classically. And over this 10 to 12 days, the symptoms will keep on worsening. And after that, the resolution starts. And therefore, the oxygen saturation will keep on decreasing when you put a pulse oximeter, and the patient might have an increasing oxygen requirement. But after about 12 days, most of the patient, the resolution starts, the recovery of the pulmonary symptoms, the pulmonary pathophysiology, this starts reducing. And either there will be total resolution of these symptoms, or in many cases, there will be some degree of fibrosis that will be left behind in the lungs. And what happens to the other organs? In the heart, there is myositis, myocarditis. In the muscles, if it spreads into the muscles, there is myositis. In the liver, it causes hepatitis, and in the brain, meningoencephalitis. So The ACE receptors are present in the muscles, so you get myositis. So the muscles have an enzyme called CPK, and therefore if you check CPK, it might come high. So many cases, that's an inflammatory marker in COVID. In the heart, it causes myocarditis, so inflammation of the heart muscles. So the heart has two enzymes. One is CPK-MB, that is creatinine phosphokinase, the MB fraction, the myocardial fraction. And the other is the troponin T and troponin I. So nowadays we measure troponin I. And therefore, if you do these markers and if they are high, that's an indicator that the patient has got myocarditis. And if we check the liver function, you find that the liver enzyme, the AST and the ALT, they increase, and that is because of the hepatitis. And in the brain, it causes meningoencephalitis. And in a small proportion of cases, what we see that the patient might have progressive drowsiness, and some of the patient might go on to develop coma also. Some of them can get convulsions. And this is because of meningoencephalitis, that is a virus having entered the brain and causing a diffuse inflammation of the cerebral tissue. And that causes meningoencephalitis. So this is how the virus affects different areas of the body, although primarily it is a pulmonary manifestation. Now let's understand how does this virus cause damage to the body. Now this is very important to understand. How does the virus cause damage to the body? And there is various mechanism by which the virus can cause damage to the body. One is the direct viral injury. So as we said, the virus will enter the cell and start multiplying within the cell, and then it will burst the cell. The cell will break, and that's a direct viral injury. So when it breaks, those millions of virus starts affecting other cells. So millions and billions of virus will, attack millions and billions of the human body cells via the ACE receptors, and they will destroy these cells. So that is the direct viral injury. So that injury is also occurring in the lung. The second mechanism is by cellular infiltration and inflammation. So as soon as the body recognizes some foreign particle having come in, the first line of defense is the neutrophils. The neutrophils and the natural killer cells and the mast cells, these are modification of the WBCs, they start attacking these virus, and they try to destroy the virus. They also try and attack the cells which the virus has invaded. And therefore, in doing so, in attacking the cells which the virus has infected, these viruses, this inflammation, there will be inflammation because of that. And that cellular inflammation is the result of a second way in which the virus causes damage. Now, the third mechanism by which it will cause damage is by endothelial dysfunction. Now, the endothelium is the endothelium of the arterioles, the arteries, and the small capillaries. So the inner lining of the arterioles and arteries is called endothelium. And what the virus does, it causes endothelialitis, that is inflammation of the endothelial layer. And that inflammation causes endothelial dysfunction. And there is a factor in this endothelium, which is called VWF. Most of you students might be aware of that, von Willebrand factor. And as soon as the endothelium has a lot of VWF in it, and as soon as there is endothelialitis, that VWF is released, and that causes a coagulation cascade. And that coagulation cascade causes thrombosis to occur within the vessels. And therefore, the thrombosis occurs in large number of capillaries of the lung system, that is the pulmonary vasculature, and also the small arteries and the arterioles. And it also occurs in the bronchial arteries. The bronchial artery is what supplies the blood to the lungs. So lung has a dual blood flow. One is through the pulmonary vasculature, through which the oxygenation of the blood takes place. But the lung itself gets its blood, because the lung tissue also needs blood for its function. So that is through the bronchial vessels. And what happens in COVID is that there is a large amount of thrombosis which is taking place in the capillaries, the small arterioles of the pulmonary vasculature, and also the bronchial arteries which supply the lung itself. Now, let me add something to this. Now, when there is lot of this kind of thrombosis which is occurring in the pulmonary vasculature and the lung itself is getting affected through the bronchial arteries, you can understand that if you ask a COVID patient who's symptomatic, who's got some degree of pulmonary involvement, if you ask this patient to do breathing exercises, you are going to actually cause injury to an already ischemic damaged tissue. So in COVID, there is a lot of alveolitis, that is inflammatory changes in the lungs, but there are a lot of ischemic changes also. And therefore, if you try to give a chest physiotherapy and a breathing exercise to a COVID patient, you are going to cause barotrauma and lung injury. And therefore, you must have seen a lot of videos circulating of breathing exercises in COVID. Yes, you can do breathing exercises before the onset of COVID as a preventive measure, and you can do breathing exercises after COVID has recovered completely. That is, you know that there is no ischemic damage left in the pulmonary system. That's the time that you have to start the breathing exercises and probably some degree of chest physiotherapy. So that's the third way, that is a lot of thrombosis which causes damage to the lung tissue. The next mechanism is what is called cytokine storm. So this COVID virus, that it causes an immune modulation, so understand this properly. COVID causes immune modulation and immune escape. That is, somehow the COVID virus escapes the direct attack from the immune system. It manages to escape that, but it doesn't stop at that. It kind of modulates or it modifies the immune response. And that is why there is a release of large amount of cytokines. And these cytokines are interleukins 1, 2, 6, and also tumor necrosis factor, TNF, and many other cytokines. And these cytokine release will cause a very, very large amount of infiltration from neutrophils and lymphocytes and cause a widespread inflammation in the lung tissue and also in many other tissues of the body. Now, what I said is that COVID causes immune modulation. So mind you, it does not cause immune suppression. So our experience shows that most of the COVID patient, 99% of the COVID patient, does not get a secondary infection. So when we used to have patients having malaria or dengue or typhoid, etc., we used to see that the immunity would go down. And because the immunity would go down, they would catch another infection. So in dengue, we were always worried about secondary infection. But somehow in COVID infection, we don't really see secondary infection at all. And in 99% of the cases, even after they get admitted, we don't have to give them antibiotics at all. Probably this would be of interest for you PharmD students. So if you're seeing left, right, and center antibiotics being used in COVID, there is something wrong in that. Most of the patients will not have a secondary bacterial infection, and they will not be prone to a secondary bacterial infection because COVID does not cause immune suppression. In fact, it causes immune modulation. So when we treat the COVID patient with steroids, that's when some degree of immune suppression takes place. Now, the next mechanism is hypoxic damage to the organs and tissue. Now, I want you to understand this also properly. So when the lungs get totally involved, the saturations goes down, the partial pressure of oxygen in the blood goes down. Now, because the partial pressure goes down, there is hypoxia in the entire body. Now you can imagine that the brain, the heart, the kidney, the liver, the muscles, all these organs and tissues, they are not getting enough oxygen. And therefore, this lack of oxygen causes a hypoxic damage to these organs. So the longer the COVID will last and the longer the duration of hypoxia in a particular patient, the longer the chances of they getting hypoxic damage. Now, where is this most evident? It is most evident in the heart. So there are some 2D echo that I have done in COVID patients. So in COVID patient, if we see that, you know, that there's some degree of ECG changes or arrhythmias, we do a 2D echo. And in some of them, at least, I have found dilated cardiomyopathy. Now, this dilated cardiomyopathy occurs because of various reasons. One is the myocarditis itself. That is, a COVID can cause viral myocarditis, that is infiltration in the lungs, in the heart itself. And the cytokine storm can damage the heart. That's another way in which the dilated cardiomyopathy occurs. But it also occurs because heart is a dynamic organ. It has to keep on pumping. And when heart doesn't get enough oxygen, there is damage to the myocardial fibers. And that damage also leads to a dilated cardiomyopathy. And that's why that worsens the picture. The picture of breathlessness in COVID gets worsened when myocarditis also sets in, and that causes a lowering of the ejection fraction of the heart. Then, of course, if there are coexisting comorbidities, that will worsen the damage in a COVID patient. And finally, the drug side effects will cause damage in a COVID patient. Now, when we are looking at a COVID patient, all these mechanisms come into our mind, and we try to see which mechanism is playing the more important role in one particular patient. Now, what is the clinical course of COVID? COVID can be absolutely asymptomatic. You know, 80% people, they don't get any problem at all, but they can spread it to others. So asymptomatic people can definitely spread the infection to others. So when we talk, the aerosols that come out of our mouth, that can go and they can spread. And therefore, the social distancing of physical distancing of 6 feet is recommended. Why 6 feet? Because experimentally, it has been shown that the particles, the aerosols that come out of our mouth can range from 5 micron to 500 micron. So the 500 micron, above kind of 100 microns, the particles within 3 feet, they settle down. And the remaining particles can go up till about 6 feet. And very, very small particles, something like 5 to 10 microns, can carry beyond 6 feet also. And that is why the recommendation is 6 feet distancing. But is that enough? It may not be enough in all the cases. There may still be people who may maintain 6 feet distancing, but they may still catch the infection. And therefore, the aerosol, experimentally, it has been shown that it can spread up to 27 feet. So if you put a perfume in a room, on one end, you can smell it on the other end. And if the distance is even 15 feet away, you can still smell it. That shows that a perfume that sends aerosol. So aerosols can travel that far distances. And therefore, 80% patients who are asymptomatic are the people who will spread it to others. So typically, most of the patients who are admitted in the hospital, they are elderly people, and they say, we have never gone out of the house in the last 5-6 months at all. So they don't go out, but the young ones, they go out and they come and they serve them, you know, with goodwill. But, you know, in doing so, they spread it to the elder people. The younger ones get no symptoms, but the elder people suffer and they land up in hospital. And if not asymptomatic, you will have mild, moderate or severe COVID. Now, among the people who are symptomatic, again, about 70% would be mild, about remaining 20% will be moderate, and the rest of them will be severe. So as we go on, we will try to discuss what is this mild, moderate and severe. Now, how do you diagnose COVID infection? I guess we are all aware of this. We take a throat swab, so they put a nasal cotton thing in your nose, but you have to go right up till the posterior nasopharynx. If the technician takes it from the anterior nostril, the COVID test is going to come falsely negative. So you have to ensure that it has to go right behind. And in the oral cavity also, it has to go to the base, right in the base of the tongue and the lateral pharyngeal walls. And only then the procedure would be technically right and you might get a high degree of positivity. Antibody test, antibodies will start coming positive only after 8 days. So it will not be really used for diagnosis, but it can be used for a serological assessment, an epidemiological study, just to know how many people in the population have got infected and whether there can be a level of herd immunity. So more about herd immunity a little later. But in many cases, there is a very funny rule, or maybe rule because of compulsions, that when a patient goes to a COVID center to do a COVID test, and when they do the test, they have to first inform the municipality. And the municipality will then take their own time to report it back to the hospital or to the patient. Now, in doing so, the COVID test takes a long time. The report takes a long time to come. But as a clinician, when I'm seeing a patient and I know that the presentation is classical COVID, we want the diagnosis to be done as soon as possible. But the COVID PCR report will take at least 36 to 48 hours to come. So what do? We do a CT scan of the chest. And CT scan of the chest will show those typical changes of COVID, that is ground glass opacities, the subpleural blebs, in severe cases, the pleuritis or a mild degree of pleural effusion. And it also tells us what is called a CT score. So depending upon how many areas of the lung has been involved, there is a CT score which has been derived, which probably I will come later again. And we also do lab biomarkers. So these biomarkers are tests like the CRP, the serum ferritin, and the D-dimer test, the serum D-dimer test, and also CPK, which I discussed before, and LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, LDH levels. Now, all of them are inflammatory markers, namely the CRP, the ferritin, the CPK, that's an inflammation of the muscles that indicates that, and the LDH, that's the biomarker which is ubiquitous, present in many organs of the body, including the intestine. So that can get elevated. But a D-dimer is a marker of thrombosis in the body. So D-dimer is, what is D-dimer? D-dimer is a breakdown product of fibrinogen. So during a clot formation, fibrinogen forms and fibrinogen breaks down to FDP, fibrinogen degradation products. And a breakdown of that product is called D-dimer. So an estimation of D-dimer tells us that there is some degree of thrombosis going on in the body. So either if it is low, it might be less thrombosis. If it is high, it might be severe thrombosis going on in the entire body. But the correlation may not be as linear as I am making out it to be. Now, this is something that you have to understand. I would like you all to pay a little attention to this graph. So you can see this graph, that these are the weeks in the x-axis. What they have shown is the weeks. And the graph shows the viral load. So just see what happens. The dotted vertical line is the symptom onset period. And about 1 week prior to that is when the infection has taken place. And so 4 to 7 days, 4 to 8 days is the incubation period. And this is the way in which the viral load will keep on increasing. And therefore, probably if you do 1 week during the day of infection, means the virus has gone inside my nostril, And if I am to do a RT-PCR today, I may get it negative, of course, because the viral load inside is less. But in the next 4 to 5 days, the viral will keep on multiplying and the viral load will keep on increasing. And when the symptom starts, a day or two after the symptoms, the viral load is maximum. And about 5 to 6 days, you can see here, 5 to 6 days after the onset of symptoms, the viral load is maximum. After the first week, the viral load starts decreasing. And therefore, many times if a patient comes on day 8, now unfortunately, there is a lot of talk going on about home treatment. So people get cough and all and they feel nothing will happen. They sit at home and they start coming after day 7 or day 8 or day 9, right? Now you see what is happening. The viral load after 7 days has started coming down. So the likelihood of getting a false negative after 7, 8 or 9 days becomes very high. And therefore that causes a lot of problems to clinicians. And that will cause a lot of problems to you PharmD students also when you come into actual clinical practice. There is a rule that you can give remdesivir only if the COVID is positive. Now you would have a patient on day 10. Aishwarya, am I clear? Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
Is it understandable or it's fine?
Yes, sir. Yeah. It's totally fine, sir.
Okay, so try and understand that, if a patient comes on day 8 or day 9, and we do a CT scan, the CT scan will be full of, COVID-19 type infiltration. But about 30% chances that when we do a RT-PCR, the RT-PCR may just come negative. That's because the viral load has actually gone down. So the viral load in the throat goes down, but it has gone into the rest of the body. And you are not going to do a lung biopsy or a liver biopsy to try and isolate the virus. And as the disease progresses, you can see here, after 14 days, the viral load keeps on decreasing. And by about 4 to 5 weeks, there is very, very little viral load left in the body. In fact, in most patients, the viremia is said to settle down to a significant extent by day 12 itself. And so the damage which occurs after day 10 or day 12 is not because of virus, it is because of the body's immune system itself. So the initial 8, 9, 10 days, the damage is because of the virus itself, maximally because of the virus, and partly because of the body's immune system. But later on, the virus actually goes away from the body, and all the damage is because of the altered immune system or the immune modulation itself. So that what we discussed was the way the viral load is spreading. Now, this concept is also important. Based on this, this concept is derived, that is CT value. So when you do a PCR test, PCR, polymerase chain reaction. So one molecule, they keep on multiplying. So they keep on multiplying one molecule to make millions of copies. So one becomes two, becomes 4, 8, like that. And after about 15 or 20 cycles or 25 cycles, the load will be so much that you can detect what that molecule is. And in this case, you add a polymerase, which is specific for COVID. And that is why you get the COVID virus antigen multiplying and you identify that. Now I told you that, suppose the detection happens after 10 cycles of multiplication in the machine. Okay, let's say 13 cycles of multiplication, then the CT value will be 13. And if the detection occurs after 30 times multiplication, the CT value will be 30. That means that a low CT value means a high viral load, and a high CT value means a low viral load. That's the concept of high and low viral load. That's why ICMR and all try to make it mandatory to all the labs that they have to give the CT value. Why? Because it is felt that if initially the viral load is high, the patient is likely to get a more severe illness. And if the viral load is low, the patient might get a less severe illness. But that is not exactly true, because we have seen low viral load, that is high CT values. Cycle time, it is called. CT year is cycle time, not CT scan. It is cycle time. So one cycle, it keeps on multiplying. And that's why higher cycle time means that the viral load is less. So something like 34, 35, 36, maximum is around 40. Okay, that means that the viral load is very less. And if it is, less than 20, it means the viral load is very, very high. Something like billions and billions of virus, per ml. Now, why is that important? It is important because above around 30 CT, if somebody is positive, but if the cycle time value, CT value is about 30, that person is unlikely to infect others. That's the concept. So high CT value, that person will have less chances of infecting others. Whereas the low CT value, that means a very high viral load, that person might be able to infect others. So that's the implication epidemiologically, or as far as serosurveillance goes. Now, IgM antibody, as I said, occurs on day 8. So the test actually detects IgG antibody and total antibody, and you have to minus it and we detect IgM antibody. Now, as I told you, the CRP, C-reactive protein, lactate dehydrogenase, and serum ferritin. Ferritin is something which carries iron. So you might wonder why it should get increased in inflammation. But it does. In any inflammation on the body, ferritin increases. And therefore, CRP, LDH, ferritin denotes inflammation of the body. And therefore, again, higher the CRP, LDH, ferritin, higher is the extent of inflammation in the body, and lower the level means lower is the inflammation. And therefore, throughout the course of the COVID infection, the CRP and D-dimer and ferritin will keep on increasing. Once it starts coming down, we know that the patient is recovering. D-dimer, as we discussed, denotes clotting. PCT, you do a procalcitonin test. PCT is procalcitonin. And that specifically increases if there is a secondary bacterial infection. Now, 99% of the time when, some COVID patient, we have sent PCT, it has always come negative. Only in a very few patient who has been in the hospital for more than 15, 20 days and they need a very high flow of oxygen and they are on BiPAP and they are recumbent and they are diabetic or malignancy. Such patients, the PCT comes high and you may have to give an antibiotic. So that's the job of PharmD, right? You have to go in and check whether anything which is given is truly indicated or not. And in COVID patient, if somebody says that I'm giving an antibiotic in anticipation of a secondary bacterial infection, that is not a real right thing to do, because COVID does not get secondary infection commonly at all, because it does not cause immune suppression, it causes immune modulation. Now that's about this. And then tropi we discussed. Tropi is present in the heart, and therefore myocarditis, myocardial infarction. How will myocardial infarction occur? We know that the propensity to develop thrombosis increases in COVID. And therefore, in one particular patient, the patient might be mild, moderate, or severe. And this has happened quite often, unfortunately. The patient is pretty, stable. He's got mild COVID. And then the clot forms in the artery of the heart and he gets a heart attack. He gets a myocardial infarction and that causes mortality. So that myocardial infarction is because of COVID indirectly. Now, interestingly, when you take this patient up for angiography, 90% of the time you will find that the arteries are clear. Why? Because the flow of blood is slower in the veins and faster in the arteries. And therefore, the veins clot faster than the arteries in COVID. And therefore, this is the myocardial area and this is the vein draining it. In COVID-induced myocardial infarction is the vein where the clot is formed. Okay, the vein is what is clotted, and therefore the back pressure effects causes an ischemic area that causes a myocardial infarction. And that's another interesting, unusual thing in COVID. The MIs are not arterial thrombi because of plaque formation. It is because of the entire lumen may be open of the veins, but the entire lumen is blocked with a clot, and that clot is also platelet rich. So what happens is in COVID, there is a platelet rich thrombi which is formed. And that is what causes the third point that I have mentioned here, that is thrombocytopenia. The thrombocytopenia occurs because the platelets are just getting used up. And that's called consumptive coagulopathy. Because these clots are platelet rich, the number of platelets goes down in the blood, and that causes thrombocytopenia. And if you see a peripheral smear, you see a lot of megakaryocytes. That is the precursor form of the platelets that comes into the blood. And the second point is the neutrophil lymphocyte ratio. So again, the first line of defense is the neutrophil, therefore neutrophils rise. But later on, the lymphocytes try to attack. So the lymphocytes are the specific defense mechanism, and therefore they try to attack, and that causes the lymphocyte count to drop, because all the lymphocytes goes inside the lungs and inside the muscles, inside the myocardium to try and attack the virus and the cells which are affected by the virus. And that is why the lymphocyte counts goes down, and therefore lower the lymphocytes, more severe is the viral load. That is the conclusion. And therefore, N by L ratio is derived from that. If the lymphocyte count becomes less than 10, 8, 6, in fact, it is less than 6. If the lymphocyte count is less than 6, it indicates a poor prognosis. Now, there is a cytokine which is called interleukin-6. And interleukin-6 causes inflammation. It's released and a lot of inflammation. So bear this in mind, because it's got therapeutic implications. Now, this is how, try to see this graph, time course. The x-axis is a time course, and the y-axis is a severity of illness. And you see this viral response. You will see that as the illness progresses, the amount of virus keeps going down. But somewhere when the viral, the body is fighting the viral and trying to get the virus down, but then there is an immune escape or an immune modulation. And the remaining time of COVID, the host inflammatory response phase is what is causing most of the damage. So that is what happens in the later part of the days of the infection. So if you see the blue boxes, the clinical symptom initially, you will get cough and sometimes diarrhea and headache and body aches, etc. Later on, maybe after 7-8 days, very variable in different people, there will be some shortness of breath and there will be hypoxia, and the saturation might go on. And from here, either there will be resolution, and if there is no resolution in a small proportion of cases, there will be ARDS, or there will be a severe shock-like syndrome. And correspondingly, you can see that these are the things which occurs: the lymphocyte count going down, D-dimer goes up, and then later on, the CT scan shows changes, and finally, the inflammatory markers become very high. Now, how do we assess the progression of the illness? And therefore, classically, you would know that everybody says that we should carry a pulse oximeter with you. Now, in assessing, what we do is that we see the pulse oximeter at rest. And in the admitted patient, you see that, with oxygen, what is the saturation? And then we do what is called a 6-minute walk test. So when I am sitting, I need, let's say, my internal body needs, X amount of oxygen. When I am walking, the demand for oxygen increases by my body. and the pulse oximeter is placed in my finger. So when I'm sitting, it's getting enough oxygen. Saturation is about 95, 96, let's say. When I'm walking and if my lung is involved with COVID, you know, the lung is unable to give enough oxygen to the blood. So the entire body gets less oxygen and therefore less oxygen is going into my finger. And that's why when we assess, the saturation starts going down. So what we see is that at rest, the patient has, let's say, 98% saturation. And after 6 minute walk test, if the saturation has dropped down to 94 or 93, that means indirectly that the lungs are involved. Indirectly, it means that the gas exchange is not very efficient in the lungs. And therefore, when the patient starts walking, the oxygen saturation drops down. On the contrary, if at rest it is 98 and after 6 minutes walking, the saturation is still 98, then we know that when the body demands more oxygen, the lung is able to provide the oxygen. That means the pulmonary involvement is less. And therefore, the 6 minute walk test is a very, very good clinical indicator of the lung involvement. So this is what we always do at rest, liters of oxygen needed, and after a 6 minute walk test. Of course, if the patient becomes very bedridden or something, then we cannot do a 6 minute walk test. And how do we assess? We assess like this clinically, the symptoms, we assess the oxygen which is needed. We do the blood test to see the biomarkers like we discussed. And of course, we do a CT scan chest to see how much of the lung is involved. And that is done by the CT score. So the CT score, okay, let me tell you, here's a CT score. You know, there are, you know, lobes of the right and left lung. So they have divided all these lobes and a total score of 25. So there are five lobes, five segments, and total score is 25. If the score is 1 to 8, it means mild COVID. 9 to 15 is moderate COVID and 16 to 25 is severe COVID. So when you enter the wards, you will see patients, they will write CT score is 12, which means that this patient has moderate lung involvement. Or you will see a CT score which is 1 or 2. And if a CT score is 1 or 2, it means very, very mild COVID infection. And if that patient has been started remdesivir, you as PharmD student should question, why remdesivir? The patient has very, very mild infection. Why do we need remdesivir? But if you see that a score of 2 after 4 days has progressed to a score of 7 or 8 or 9, that means this patient has got a progressive COVID. And therefore, if you see remdesivir is not given, you should say, oh, this patient is progressing. Why is remdesivir not been given in this patient? Why has steroids not been given in this patient? Now, if you see, for example, a biomarker, D-dimer, which is less than 500, and you find that the low molecular weight heparin has been started, you can ask why has been started. The indication is that above 500 D-dimer, you should start, you know, Clexane, although there is a lot of, controversies in that. I, for one, like to start it much before the D-dimers go high, if I feel that the patient is progressing. Now, this graph is not as complicated as it looks like. You see that the first graph is of platelet. Second one is APTT, activated TTT. So you ignore that. You see the third one, D-dimer. You see the FDP, the last one. So see what is happening to platelet. The red line is the people who have not survived. And the blue line is people who have survived. And what they did in this graph is people who have not survived, how did their platelets behave? And you can see that the platelets really drop down. So platelets going down rapidly in this manner is a bad prognosis. If the platelet is going down rapidly, that is a bad prognosis for survival. But if the initial, these are the number of days. So if I see that the platelet has not dropped down too much, what does that tell me? It tells me that probably the clotting is not that severe in this patient. The thrombosis is not that severe. the platelets are not getting consumed. And that is why the platelets are not dropping. And therefore, if platelets are not dropping, there is less clotting in the body. Therefore, the prognosis is good. And therefore, if the platelets, survivors, you see that the platelets do not drop much. Let's go down to the D-dimer. See what is happening to the D-dimer. Again, the red one is non-survivor. The blue one is the survivor. If initially day 4 itself or day 7, you see that the D-dimer is very high, we are very cautious. We are scared. We know that the prognosis is not very good. But if on day 4, day 7, day 10, the D-dimer is not very high, we know that this patient is likely to develop a mild COVID. The patient is likely to recover. So you can see that post day 16, post day 14 around, you know, the D-dimer starts coming down. Whereas in non-survivors, even after 14 or 16 days, there is an uptake of D-dimer. It keeps going high, and that indicates a bad prognosis. Same kind of a thing is followed by the FDP, which is related to D-dimers and the fibrinogen. Now again, similar thing, interleukin 6 that we said is a cytokine. So if there is a severe cytokine, you know that the interleukin levels should be very high. And you can see in this graph, again, the blue is the survivors and the red one is a non-survivor. And if initially itself is, if you see that the interleukin levels are high, we are very cautious. We are very cautious because this particular patient might, you know, go into a severe cytokine storm. And you see that post day 13, most of the patients, they stabilize and the interleukin levels remain flat or it even comes down. Whereas in non-survivors or in one with poor prognosis, the interleukin levels keeps on going up very high rather. And same kind of thing occurs with ferritin. The non-survivors, the levels are very high. The survivors, it is low. It goes up till, 10,000 also in some people, non-survivors. That's a poor prognosis. Same thing for cardiac troponin I. You see how after day 16, it shoots up in non-survivors, whereas survivors, it doesn't shoot up. And these are the patients who lands up with cardiac complication. So let's move on to treatment of virus. So the treatment of virus, Aishwarya, if people are getting bored, you tell me, I will cut it short.
No, am sir. I okay?
Yeah, okay. So let's move on to treatment of virus. So what treatment of COVID? So this is the way to look at it. How do we treat COVID infection? So we divide it into the following things. Now, if we treat all these following subheadings, we do not miss out on a treatment of COVID patient. So the first thing, we want to attack the virus. So we have some treatment to kill the virus. That's what I written first. The second is the inflammation. We want some treatment to decrease the inflammation. The third, we saw the pathophysiology. Thrombosis is taking place in the body. So we want that the thrombosis should not take place in the body. The fourth, cytokine storm. Can we do something to reduce the cytokine storm? The fifth is that the lungs are getting involved with pneumonia and the oxygenation might be going down. So you need to give oxygen. So what are the ways in which we give oxygen therapy? Then of course, if there are comorbidities, he's got diabetes, he's got hypertension, ischemic heart disease, you're not going to stop that treatment. You're going to continue that treatment. COVID damage occurs because of oxidizing radicals. So inflammation in the body is because of oxidizing radicals. And that is why that's the next heading. We need antioxidants. And finally, if the COVID recovers, we need to do a lot of rehabilitation. Now let us see what we do for each subheading. What do we have for the virus? What can we do to kill the virus? So see, these are all the subheadings. One is hydroxychloroquine. I think you are PharmD students. You don't want details about what is HCQS. It has some antiviral activity in vitro. And that's why it is used in vivo. How did somebody think of hydroxychloroquine? Very interesting story. So in Wuhan, when the epidemic was spreading and people were getting admitted in the hospital, they found that in the skin department, the admitted patient in the skin department, patients who had SLE, they were not getting COVID infection. Okay, the patient of SLEs in the skin department were not getting COVID infection. So the doctors tried to find out why this is happening. Why is the SLE not getting COVID? And they thought that HCQS, all of them were on HCQS because rheumatoid arthritis and this, they were not getting COVID. And they knew that HCQS has some antiviral activity. So they postulated that HCQS probably is, protective against the viral infection, and it can be given for prophylaxis. And that is why they propagated that HCQS you should use for prophylaxis, and the world took it over, and Trump made a big statement about it, and the entire world started taking HCQS. Now, why once a week? Because it's got a long half-life, and therefore once a week is given. But now there are reports after reports which are trying to state that HCQS probably doesn't help at all. What do I feel? I don't know. It has some activity. And for want of anything better, we better keep taking HCQS. Now the latest thing, ICMR has come up with a statement saying that ivermectin, that's our third topic, ivermectin has antiviral activity, and we can give ivermectin as prophylaxis. The final word is not out yet. Doxycycline, azithromycin has some antiviral. Zinc has antiviral activity in vitro, in large doses. Very large doses. And that is why the dosages of zinc given to COVID patient is not fixed. Some people give 50 milligram, some people as high as 500 milligram. And so certain common preparation like Bicosul Z or Bicozinc, they have a range from 50 to 150 milligram. And so we use that in COVID therapy. Next is Favipiravir. Again, as pharma student, Favipiravir is a drug which was initially used for, influenza, common cold, that is influenza. And it was manufactured as a 200 milligram tablet. And therefore, when COVID started, they found that we can use it for COVID, but in experimentally, they had to use a very high dose for COVID infection. They had to use 1,800 milligram as the loading dose, and about 800 milligram for a period of 10 to 14 days. But the approval, they did not get an approval for making a 500 or a 800 milligram tablet, and therefore Favipiravir is available at 200 milligram. And if you have to give that as an antiviral, we give 9 tablets in the morning and 9 tablets at night on day one, and subsequently give 4 in the morning and 4 in the evening for the remaining 10 to 14 days. Of course, most of them recover and we cut short the duration of Favipiravir. Has it been shown experimentally or by research whether it works? Well, it has been shown in one trial to reduce the viral clearance by 14 hours. That's all. It just reduces the viral clearance time by 14 hours. That's all. That's the efficacy of Favipiravir. But for want of anything better, again, for mild cases, we use Favipiravir. What about Remdesivir? So Remdesivir was initially tried for SARS-CoV-1 and also for Ebola virus. But it did not seem to have effect in Ebola virus, and SARS-CoV-1, the study stopped because the epidemic went away. It was also tried in MERS. So again, because of this pandemic, they tried to do the research in Remdesivir. So first they did in China, in Wuhan. So Wuhan, they enrolled a few number of patients, I think around 400 or so. And they found no benefit. So the Chinese in the initial clinical trial did not find benefit of Remdesivir. So the US people, they took about 1,200 people and they did a research with Remdesivir, and they found a positive result. What they found, that the median duration of viral clearance will reduce by 3 to 4 days. That is, the viral without the drug is to get cleared off in 15 days. with remdesivir, it will get cleared off in 11 days. So the difference of 4 days. So remdesivir is no magic, but it can reduce the viral clearance by a few days. Is it important? Yes, it is. Even if we reduce the viral clearance by a few days, it is enough to prevent the patient from going into a cytokine storm, and you might just protect the patient's, you know, and prevent his getting into mortality. And therefore, remdesivir is now the mainstay as an antiviral therapy. Of all this, remdesivir is the mainstay. What is convalescent plasma? If somebody has got a COVID infection and he or she has become totally all right, then after 3 to 4 weeks, he will have a very, very good level of antibodies in his body. So the postulate is that that antibodies, if you put in a patient who is suffering from COVID, you will get a good result. And therefore, you take plasma from the patient who is recovered and you give it to the patient who's got an active COVID. Does it work? Very, very variable results from many places. In fact, in the US, the emergency use on a compassionate ground, which they had given for convalescent plasma, has been taken away about 10 days ago. So in US, they are saying that it's not really effective. What they are saying in India, ICMR tried to say that convalescent plasma is not very useful, but many people who are doing it, different people who are doing it, are saying that they are getting good results. But you know, we have not done a proper double-blind trial in India. So, you know, the word is open whether we should do convalescent plasma or not. But the most important thing to remember is that after 12 days of COVID, if you do a convalescent plasma, we saw from what did we learn in the previous slides, we saw that the viremia is almost gone by 12, 13, 14 days. So in a severe case, if you try to do a convalescent plasma, what are you doing it for? There is no virus left in the body. And therefore, if you give antibodies at 15 days, there is no need for it at all. So when should you give the convalescent plasma? Let me go back a few slides. We'll come back. We have to give the convalescent plasma when the viral load is at peak, right? That is about a few days after incubation period. And therefore, that antibody will act at that level. If you give it later on, the viral load is less, it's not going to work at all. So the problem is that when the viral load is peak, and if you just give a convalescent plasma, we don't know, 80% of the patient might just recover on its own. So, you know, we don't know which patient is going to deteriorate and which patient is going to, you know, just settle down. And that is the problem in deciding who should receive convalescent plasma. And therefore, many centers are giving it when the patient becomes very serious. After 15 days of, suffering from COVID, they give convalescent plasma. Now, logically, from what we have discussed, it's not going to work. And if you give it too early, you might be, causing, side effects of the plasma itself, and you may not be benefiting the patient at all. And therefore, the final word on convalescent plasma is not there. Now, monoclonal antibodies. Now, this is interesting. This is something which might work in the near future if it comes up in a big way. Now, what happens is, suppose somebody has got COVID and is recovered. So there are antibodies in his body. Are there only one type of antibody in his body? No, there are multiple types of antibodies in his body. Some of the antibodies are neutralizing antibodies. That is, they are very effective. Neutralizing means if that antibody attaches to the virus will get destroyed. Many of the antibodies just attaches to the body. It may not have any significant effect. Some of the antibodies can attach and, the virus gets recognized by the natural killer cells or the mast cells, and they engulf that virus and try to destroy it. So what is done in monoclonal antibody, that these antibodies are studied. That is, which is the most effective antibody, which is the less effective antibody, which is the moderately effective antibody. Now, suppose we identify the most effective antibody, So we take that antibody, we identify that, and we make a clone of that. That is called monoclonal. We make a clone of that antibody and we multiply it. That is, we synthesize it. We artificially synthesize it. And therefore, you get a significantly large concentration of monoclonal antibodies. That is the antibodies which are highly effective and the antibodies which can neutralize the virus. And these antibodies you put inside the patient. Now, logically, from what we have discussed, you know that if you give these kind of antibodies to some patients, they will respond wonderfully. But it is still in a research stage. Very good results have been found in some centers, but some centers are reporting, ambiguous results, working or not working. But it is something which we have to look forward to. So these are all the ways which we are attacking the virus. But is our job over? Is our job over if we just try to kill the virus? No, because the body's immune system is also damaging the body in COVID. And that is, what do we do for inflammation? For all that inflammation in the body, the mainstay is steroids. The mainstay is steroids. And that steroids we use in the form of dexamethasone or methylprednisolone. And the dosages are there. Dexameth is 6 milligram 2 or 3 times a day. And it is for a duration of 10 days. Many centers use methylprednisolone, but the research has been done with dexamethasone in London, in England. And they have found a 30% benefit in patient not going on to a ventilator. So dexameth is one drug which has been clinically proven, research proven to be beneficial in COVID. But many centers use methylprednisolone also. Now we talked about one cytokine called interleukin-6. So when interleukin-6 keeps on going up, it induces a lot of cytokine storm. So if you identify one particular patient where the IL-6 level is increasing, so while it is increasing, there is a drug which blocks the IL-6 receptors. That is, this is the IL-6, this is the receptor in the cells. So the IL-6 binds to the receptor and sets up a cytokine storm. So tocilizumab is a drug which will block this receptor. So when it blocks the receptors, the cytokine storm does not take place and it gets suppressed. And therefore, this is the drug which we carefully select the patient, which patient is worsening, which patient has got IL-6, which is going high. And that is why we try to give it there. And if we give it at the right time, if we give it at the right time with the proper patient selection with a high IL-6 and an IL-6, which is increasing, tocilizumab works very nicely. Now, what has happened? Many people just arbitrarily have given tocilizumab. That is, they give when the patient has already become severe, when the cytokine storm has already taken a lot of toll in the body. That is the time they give, and it does not work. And some people give it much earlier, when the IL-6 may be slightly high, but the patient may not really be going into a cytokine storm, and they give tocilizumab, and it does not work. And therefore, some centers say that it does not work, and some say that it works. My personal experience, if I am able to find out that one particular patient is landing into a cytokine storm, so during the worsening phase, when the IL-6 is increasing, when the patient is worsening, if I hit at the right time, it works wonderfully. There is some role of anti-inflammation in antihistaminics and Montelukast, but it's not very proven, but we do give it. And antioxidant, as I said, like vitamin C, etc. We know that most of the damage is because of oxidizing radicals, and therefore we give antioxidants. Now, what do we do for thrombosis? We give a low molecular weight heparin, and that is given in the form of one of the brands twice a day, of a low molecular weight heparin. And we have to continue it for many days, 2 to 3 weeks post recovery also, especially in patients who have mild, moderate or severe illness. But now, because many patients don't want to take injection, we also use NOAC. That's called novel oral anticoagulants. That is two brands, dabigatran and epacadostat. twice a day. So these are given twice a day for a period of 14 days to 2 weeks. Now, we also give supplements, like we said, antioxidants, and we try to, put it a lot of antioxidants in the diet also. We can take natural antioxidants in the diet. Now the patient is getting ARDS, his oxygen levels are going down. So what are the ways in which we give oxygen? First is we use a nasal prong or a mask, where up till maximum of 6 liters oxygen we can give. If the patient worsens, we give what is called a non-rebreathing mask, and that can give a maximum of 12 to 15 liters of oxygen. Now the ARDS has worsened even more, and therefore we need something else. And therefore a new thing has come up, which is called high flow nasal cannula. So it's a machine, and there are big tubes which is attached to the nose, and it can give a maximum of 60 liters oxygen per minute. And along with that, or in association with that, if the breathing becomes difficult, then we put a patient on BiPAP or a CPAP, that is continuous positive airway pressure, and in that we can go up till a fraction of inspired oxygen, FiO2 of 100%. And if the patient goes into a respiratory fatigue, that is, the patient is tachypneic, hypoxic for a long period of time, and the patient muscles are weak now, he's tired, he's unable to breathe at all. And you know that if you leave the patient like that, the patient's muscles will not be able to take the work of breathing, because the work of breathing becomes very high. And that is the time where we put the patient on invasive ventilator. But we try not to put a patient on invasive ventilator, because the results are not good. Because as I said, there's a lot of inflammatory and ischemic damage to the lungs because of the thrombosis. Inflammatory and ischemic damage to the lungs. So when we are breathing naturally, when we inhale like this, there is a negative pressure in the lungs. When the chest expands, there's a negative pressure in the lungs. When you put somebody on a tube and put a patient on mechanical ventilator, when the patient breathes, the air is pushed inside and there is a positive pressure in the lungs. So during ventilator-induced breathing, there is a positive pressure in the lungs when the patient is doing an inspiration. And that positive pressure kind of, pushes the lung tissues, and they can tear apart, they can rupture, they can break, and we can cause what is called barotrauma. And that barotrauma is very common in patients of COVID, because the lung tissue is weak because of alveolitis, inflammation, and thrombosis. So that is something that you have to keep in mind. When a patient is on ventilator, the prognosis is not good in COVID. What is ECMO? Extracorporeal membrane oxygenation. Sometimes the lungs are so damaged that even with a ventilator, the oxygen is still low. And then what you do, so you must all be knowing about hemodialysis. So when the kidney fails, you put a tube from here, the blood goes in the machine, it purifies and gets it back. So the ECMO is similar. The blood will go in the machine, something like the hemodialysis. But instead of removing dirt, what it does, it gives oxygen to the blood through the machine. The machine has a filter, a lung. And the blood passes through that artificial lung, the machine, and the blood is oxygenated and put inside the body. And that's called ECMO. So the ECMO is available only in a very few centers in Mumbai, and outside Mumbai, only in the major metropolitan cities, some of the places have ECMO. Does it work? Not really. Somehow, the concept is very good, but it doesn't really help. Maybe because such patients are already very critical. Patients who require ECMO are already critical, and therefore probably it doesn't really work well. But these are the ways in which we give oxygen. And we do some supplementation. We give antioxidant, vitamin C, vitamin D. Why vitamin D? Vitamin D has been shown to preserve the pulmonary alveoli, the integrity of the pulmonary alveoli. Of course, it is most useful if you are taking it continuously for a long time. That is much before you got COVID. And therefore, when a patient if somebody asks you what is to be done to build up immunity and prophylaxis, yes, we give HCQS. We may give ivermectin, but we give multivitamins as a general thing. We give antioxidants like vitamin C. We give vitamin D because they will improve the pulmonary integrity of the pulmonary. We give good nutrition and we try to give natural antioxidants in the diet, like, you know, bell peppers, etc., ginger. All those things are natural antioxidants. Why good nutrition? Because we know that inflammation is taking in the entire body in COVID patients. That is the lungs, and if it spreads, the muscles, the liver. Inflammation means utilization of a lot of energy by the body. The body is in a severe catabolic phase. And a large number of COVID patients has a lot of weight loss, 4 to 10 kgs of weight loss they get. And that's why, as an immunity builder, you need a good balanced nutrition. And during the course of COVID and during rehabilitation also, you need good balanced nutrition with a lot of supplementation in the form of multivitamins, minerals, and antioxidants. So now you will understand what we have to do in rehabilitation. We know that the lung function is affected, so you have to assess the lung function. We know that there is catabolic state, patient has lost a lot of weight, lost muscle mass, psychologically is stressed out, so you've got to assess the clinical status. Now is the time you start the breathing exercises. When the patient is COVID pneumonia, we do not give breathing exercises. So if somebody is, you know, giving exercises, I'll tell you again, you know, for example, if breathing exercises, you take a deep breath and you hold the breath. Now the lung is already, you know, hypoxic. And if you do a breathing exercises and you hold a breath, you are causing hypoxia. So any breathing exercises where you hold the breath, you will get hypoxia. Secondly, the ischemic damage, inflamed lung. If you do heavy breathing, that is, you know, heavy excursion of your lung expansion and contraction, you are going to damage the lung. So, you know, many days after 4-5 days of total recovery from clinical COVID, that's when you start breathing exercises. We talked about nutrition. A lot of them undergo a lot of psychological stress. In fact, pre-COVID and post-COVID, at least 5% of my daily OPD nowadays is psychological stress because of COVID anxiety. Either it is genuinely they have lost, each and every one of you as of today. If you see one of my talk I had given in March, I had said that within a few months, each of us, unfortunately, will know somebody who has not survived with COVID. Will know somebody, you know, somebody, aunt, uncle, relative, friend, friends, father, grandfather, somebody. That is the situation that we are already going through. That is all of us, even now in, you know, this month itself, all of us, I'm sure, know somebody who got affected by COVID and who probably have not survived. What can we do for lung fibrosis? One new drug is being recommended, pirfenidone, which was actually used for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. And now there are some, you know, studies which are saying that people with, you know, COVID lung fibrosis, we can use this drug. Again, something for PharmD students. When to start it, how long to start this. This is something which will help in reducing the pulmonary fibrosis, reducing the inflammation, reducing the COVID oxidizing inflammation. Pirfenidone actually reduces the oxidizing damage and inflammation in the lungs. So that's about COVID and everything. Now we'll come to vaccination. Okay, so let's start with vaccination. So you know what is vaccination, polio vaccine and smallpox vaccine, what were they? So polio was two types of vaccine, Sark and Sabin. So one was a live virus, live attenuated virus, live weakened virus, live attenuated virus. And one was a dead virus. Sabin was a dead virus and Sark was a live virus. So the live virus, what they did, we put drops in kids. So the live weakened virus would go in the intestine, they will multiply. multiply a little bit, but they are weakened. They will not cause disease, but they will set up an immune reaction. And there will be very strong antibodies formed against that, and that will protect that patient. Okay, that was the concept, and it worked wonderfully. That was live, that was attenuated virus, or the Sabin virus was dead virus. So if it is dead, if you put it in a mouth, it will die inside, right? It's already dead, nothing will happen. So that has to be given as an injection. So I'm just using polio to explain, you know, attenuated and dead virus. So that causes antibody formation, that gives protection. Will it work in COVID? Can you give a live attenuated virus in COVID? Can you give a dead virus in COVID? Yes or no? I should have taken a poll here, Aishwarya. So I want to know, chat box, if you can say, can we give a live attenuated or a dead virus in COVID? What do you think? From all the discussions that we had, can I get an answer somehow in the chat box? Aishwarya, you will volunteer?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Participants, if it's possible, can you please answer in the chat box? Or I'll try arranging for a poll.
Can you give a attenuated or a live attenuated or a dead virus as a vaccine in COVID from the discussions we had? Priyanka is raising hands to say what? I don't know. Any answers? I can't see the chat box here.
So many people have, like majority, I guess, they've gone with the dead virus.
Okay.
Yes, and some amount of people have written live attenuated virus.
Okay, so what did we discuss? We saw that after day 10, day 12, the virus is gone from the body, right? The virus is gone from the body and the remaining damage is done by the body itself, the immune modulation of the body. Now, the fear is that if I give a dead virus inside, the virus can induce an immune modulation, right? If I give a live attenuated virus, I may at the most not cause the damage because of the direct viral injury, because the virus is dead. But the virus can cause immune modulation. It can induce a cytokine storm. And that is why you can land up in ARDS. Understood? The problems of why we cannot make a vaccine so easily in COVID. Because the virus, even if it's dead, you are giving the RNA structure. And the RNA structure of the dead virus will be identified by the immune system of the human body. But that RNA structure is modulating the immunity system and it is inducing a cytokine storm. And therefore, if you give a live attenuated virus or a dead virus, the fear is that it can escape the immune system, cause immune modulation, and it will set up a severe cytokine storm and some of the people can die also. That's one big problem. What is the second big problem? Below 20, 99.999%, nothing happens to the people. And therefore, getting COVID infection is a vaccination for them for lifelong, right? Getting an infection itself is a vaccination for them lifelong. So is it worth giving COVID vaccine to under 20? So that's the second question. Is it worth? No, you might give COVID vaccine and in one lakh young person, less than 20, you will just induce a cytokine storm and you will kill that person because of the vaccine. And therefore, that's the second major problem in manufacturing a COVID vaccine with live attenuated or a dead virus, live weakened or a dead virus. Now, so what are the approaches people are doing? So there are four actually, I think I forgot to mention one. I'll tell you that. So one is a recombinant protein vaccine. The second is a DNA-based vaccine. And the third is the mRNA-based vaccine. Now again, you know, this is pretty interesting. So, I would appreciate if all of our attention is in this. So what is recombinant DNA vaccine? Okay. So let's talk about recombinant, the third one, okay? The third one. So in recombinant protein vaccine, now we know the structure of the virus. It's got an RNA inside, it's got a lipid bilayer, it's got a lot of spikes on the surface. Now we know SARS-CoV-1, we know SARS-CoV-1 virus. SARS-CoV-1 also had a similar structure. So that was studied. Now what is important, like we learned before in our previous slide, we talked about neutralizing antibodies, okay? Now whatever if I inject in my body, the body is going to produce antibodies. So they have identified which of the spike proteins on the surface of the coronavirus SARS-CoV-1, you know, causes the best neutralizing antibody. Okay, let me tell you again. These surface proteins, the spike proteins, the glycoproteins that it is called, they have identified on basis of SARS-CoV-1, which of these spike proteins will produce the best neutralizing antibody. So suppose it is on this side, this virus, and if I, you know, take up this and put it in the body, it will produce an antibody, but it will not neutralize the virus. But if I try to take this protein out and inject in the human body, I might get a good antibody response, which will be neutralizing. That's the last line. Just go to the last line first of this slide. That is the recombinant protein vaccine. What do you do? Pieces of virus is injected. Which pieces? The pieces which we feel will produce the best neutralizing antibody. That is taken up. The virus is broken up and that is injected in the body. Now it will produce a neutralizing antibody, but we do not know which segment of the RNA or which segment in the spike protein is causing the cytokine storm. Understood? Because SARS-CoV-2 is the first virus which is causing such a severe cytokine storm. So we don't know which is going to cause the cytokine storm. And that is the problem with the recombinant protein vaccine. And that is the reason you would understand now why it is going to require a very long and, you know, phase of trials. Why you are going to require at least 30,000 to 1 lakh people where you have to do a trial. Even if one person out of that lands up in cytokine storm, that person will die. And if that you multiply that 1 lakh with 7 billion human population, let's say we inject 2 billion people, let's say 20,000 people will die of that because of the vaccine. Is it acceptable? It is not acceptable. And that is the problem with recombinant protein vaccine, but research is going in that. But before that, I want to tell you, before I tell you this, I want to tell you about what happens in dengue. Okay, the first line is about dengue. First line where I have said that immune enhancement with subsequent infection. So what happens in dengue? Dengue has 4 strains, dengue 1, 2, 3, 4. Suppose dengue 1 enters inside my body, practically nothing will happen. You know, but the antibodies and all will be produced in the body. When dengue 2 enters in the body, what happens is that the body partially recognizes the dengue 2 because it had, you know, got exposed to dengue 1. And instead of suppressing, there is an immune enhancement. In dengue fever, the subsequent dengue infection causes an immune enhancement, and that causes either clinical dengue, dengue hemorrhagic fever, or dengue shock syndrome. That is why there is no vaccine in dengue as of today. Ever wondered why nothing has come up in dengue? Because you give dengue virus, live or attenuated or dead virus, inside the body, it can induce an immune enhancement if a real dengue comes in, and you will get a dengue fever because you vaccinated the first time. And in COVID, what is happening? In the first infection itself, there is an immune escape or there is an immune modulation, and that causes that cytokine storm and all the immune-related damage to the body. And therefore, the last line, attenuated or dead COVID vaccine might induce a cytokine storm. And this is what is happening. The first line is what is happening in dengue. And now come back to the type of ways in which we are trying to, you know, the world is trying to make a vaccine. We talked about the last one, recombinant protein vaccine. What is the second last one? The mRNA vaccine. So what they will do? Again, the glycoprotein on the surface of SARS-CoV-2, which has the best chances of producing an antibody response, that genetic code is taken, okay? That genetic code is taken because the genetic mapping of the COVID virus has been done, okay? That came up, pretty early. The Chinese did that and gave it to the world, everybody, so that everybody can start studying it and trying to produce a vaccine. And therefore, what they do, that genetic code is taken from the virus, and this is another mRNA. It is put in this mRNA, and that is injected in the body. Now, what that will do, that will enter the cells. That will enter some of the cells, and that mRNA will take over the cell, and that will produce that antigen. That antigen coded on the surface of SARS-CoV-2. So it will produce a segment of the viral protein in the human body. It will produce that segment of the viral protein. That production will act as an antigen, and the body will produce an antibody against that. And if a subsequent virus infection comes in, it will fight against that. That is mRNA. Now I'm going to tell you a little more detail about this in the subsequent set. What is DNA vaccine? What is an RNA virus? If you have this COVID as RNA virus, what is a DNA doing in an RNA virus? So what is done is that they have taken a DNA molecule, and that DNA molecule, is modified. That DNA molecule's nucleotides is modified, so that it can produce the antigens of SARS-CoV-2. And that is injected in the human body. And that will go into the skin cells. It is produced intradermally. It is injected intradermally. It goes in that area, skin cells, and it takes over the cell function, and it makes the cell produces that antigen, and that antigen will produce antibody, activate the immune system, produce antibody, and those antibodies will be protective against the COVID virus. Now, that all sounds, these are the actual thing which, companies like Abbott, the Moderna, the Eli Lilly, and the Oxford, these people are doing. These people are doing research in these kind of vaccine. Now, let us see what vaccine we have. So, you understood the basis. So, the Vladimir Putin, he said that our virus is ready. So is it ready? Is the Russian virus ready? What do we know about that virus? They have called it the Sputnik virus. That was the first aircraft, unmanned aircraft they sent into the space. But what do we know about this thing, Sputnik vaccine? Details of the trial, they have not let us know. It is a vector-based vaccine. What is the vector? Adenovirus vector. So adenovirus is another virus which causes respiratory infection, okay? Rhinitis, pharyngitis, etc. So what is done is that the genetic code of COVID spike protein is introduced in the adenovirus, and the adenovirus is injected in the human body. That adenoviruses go and infect some cells, and it will produce antibodies, and that antibody will, cause protection. Now, you may ask that the adenovirus itself will cause a cold, right? And the human body might recognize the adenovirus and kill that adenovirus. So how will it work? So what is done is that when this is the full chain sequence of adenovirus, and the entire adenovirus has been studied, and they have broken parts of the adenovirus, the parts which is responsible for multiplication and infecting more cells, that has been cut off. So it's a very complicated thing. So those segments have been cut off. So when you inject, it infects only a few cells and it will not destroy those cells and it will not infect other cells. And therefore, that adenovirus itself will not cause an influenza-like syndrome, and that is why it can work. But whether these spike proteins, which the Russians have introduced in the adenovirus, whether they are producing neutralizing antibodies, they don't know, or they are not telling us, or the conclusion has not been made. That is why we have to be very, very careful. Unfortunately, you know, I'm not sure whether these factors have been taken into consideration when we have agreed for doing that vaccine trial in India. So in India, we are doing that trial and it's a double-blinded study. We will never know who's been, put in that trial. That is a secrecy clause. So we don't know anything much detail about the Sputnik vaccine. If it works, very good. But what I'm trying to stress is the difficulties in producing an effective vaccine. So that's about Sputnik vaccine. What about the Bharat Serum Covaxin? What have they done? How much do we know about it? What have they done? The first line. They have given only one line thing from what I searched. They have not given any details. They are developing an inactivated vaccine from an Indian strain of novel COVID isolated by the National Institute of Virology, probably based in Pune. Will that work? We've already discussed that. Isn't that dangerous? Yes, we've already discussed that, but we don't know. They are not coming out with any details of, you know, they did what the conventional technique was. They took the virus and they have either killed the virus or they have weakened it, attenuated it. And that they are trying to put in the inside a patient and they are trying to see whether it will induce an antibody response. Yes, it will induce an antibody response, but whether it will be protective or whether it will induce a cytokine storm, we don't know. From the theoretical discussion, it can induce a cytokine storm. That is the big danger about the Bharat Serum Covaxin. And what about Oxford vaccine? Again, it's a RNA-based vaccine. The vector is again adenovirus. So adenovirus is very well studied and that is used as a vector for many things. It is used as a vector for gene therapy. It is used as a vector for cancer therapy. So what is done is the virus is taken and the genetic code is introduced for cancer patients so that it targeted, you can target only the cancer cells. So that kind of a thing is going on. It can produce antibodies which will attach to the cancer cells and therefore the drug will work only on the cancer cells. So the adenovirus has been used for a long time for cancer therapy. And now it is being tried to be used for coronavirus vaccine. So this virus does not multiply in the body. I said that we cut off parts of the multiplication gene sequence from the adenovirus, induces and Oxford people, they have claimed that they have identified the surface protein which is most likely to produce a neutralizing antibody. How long will this pandemic last? We don't know. I think 2 to 2.5 years it is going to last. Further 2 to 2.5 years it will last and it will, either go away or it will keep on lingering to a certain extent. Alternately, it will go away from the rest of the world, but it will stay in India. Because of our population density and because we are unable to convey preventive and protective measures effectively to our population. I think that was the last slide. Thank you. Have I exceeded my limit? My God, I have. Okay. Sorry, Aishwarya, I didn't realize the time. I hope people are not bored.
No, sir. It's quite informative, sir.
So any questions for the session?
Thank you, sir.
Vaishnavi.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, sir. It was really a wonderful session. Very need of the hour. Sir, we do have questions in our both chat boxes, Zoom and YouTube. Sir, with your permission, would I take take them one by one?
Yeah, without my permission also you can take them.
Thank you, sir.
First of all, I didn't know this was a all female dominated association. So really hats off to you girls. When I saw all the organizers, it was all female. So that's really wonderful. Good. Okay, let's.
Thank you, sir. So here's our first question. Which is the most likely post-COVID-19 infection? Is it pulmonary fibrosis or cardiac complication?
Most likely post-COVID.
Yes, sir.
Okay, COVID is primarily a pulmonary disease, you know. So 95% of all symptoms are lungs. Let's say 90%, all symptoms are due to the lungs. And 90% of the complications are due to lungs. And 80 to 90% of deaths are due to lung. Either it is because of severe ARDS hypoxia or it is because of pulmonary thromboembolism. So very small percentage, they get massive myocardial infarction and die, or they get, you know, malignant arrhythmias because of arrhythmias and they die. And that is because of myocarditis. That's what PharmDs have to, you know, keep in mind. People who have myocarditis, they will be put on anti-arrhythmic drugs. So you will have to see that, you know, whether that is safe or not safe. Then HCQS, you know, probably that causes QT prolongation and that can induce ventricular fibrillation. So if HCQS is given for a long time, then you have as therapy, prophylaxis we give it just once a week. Mostly nothing really goes wrong. But when therapeutically you have to give it daily, elderly people, people with cardiac problem, they can get a complication because of HCQS. So that is something in your area you have to see and you have to alert that this guy's QTC is getting prolonged. So kindly stop this drug. So that kind of involvement you have to do in such patients. So mostly it is pulmonary, a very small proportion of patients, it is cardiac. Another small proportion of patients, it is neurological. That is the patient may be totally all right talking to you one moment and then they will get a thrombosis inside the brain. They will either get a paralytic stroke, but if it's in the midbrain, medulla oblongata or pons, if it's that, they just go into coma. I have unfortunately seen two patients going like that, you know. Mild COVID elderly patient, next moment they are in coma. So that's what unfortunately occurs. I hope that satisfies you. Next question.
Yes, sir. Next question is, for how many days corona patient can act as spreader?
Okay. So there is as I said, the viremia goes on till day 12. Okay. Now that's a general thing. Generally, the viremia will go on till day 12. But it can vary from 8 days to almost 27 days, you know. Sometimes even after a month, you know, 25, 27 days, you might still have the viremia going on. But like we discussed, like we saw, okay, my slide, okay, my screening is been stopped or what? Okay, I want to take you back to this slide that we saw. That is, this is the viremia. Can you see this viremia? Okay. And then we discuss the CT score, right? The cycle time score. So if somebody has a cycle time, the CT score less than 33, 34, 35, even if he has got a virus inside, he doesn't spread it to others because the viral load is very less. Got it? So there will be some patients, some people who will have a very low viral load and they will spread very less or may not spread at all. Whereas you see this peaking here, some people will have viral load which will be very high and they will act as super spreaders. So one person might spread to 10, 15 people also. So there is a concept called RO, R naught it is called, R and O, okay, R naught it is called. That is the reproductive index. So something like, you know, for example, typhoid has a reproductive index of 1.5. That means one person will spread to 1.5 people. What is the reproductive index of COVID? It's around 3 to 4. One person on an average will spread to 3 to 4 people. And that is also very variable. The super spreaders might spread to 10, 15 people. And the chronic spreaders might spread them for a long time. Somebody who's got a viremia going for a long time. But in general, we assume that after day 12, the viremia goes down a lot. And therefore, the quarantine, roughly, people ask for 17 to 21 days, right? Because of the variability. So 3 weeks quarantine, we assume that the person will not be able to spread it to somebody else. That is the basis of the quarantine, 15 days to 21 days. We try to stick to 21 days. Okay?
Okay, sir. So the next question is, does influenza pneumonia vaccinations help in diabetic patients infected with COVID?
No, COVID, it doesn't help. It helps in preventing the other type of pneumonias, but COVID, it doesn't help at all. It doesn't help at all.
Okay, sir.
So that's all. Okay, I thought there'll be more questions.
Yeah, sir, there are more questions yet. Sir, the another comes from YouTube says, there are suggestions that the dosage of oral anti-diabetic drugs may need to be reduced in diabetic COVID-19 patients. If is it so, how does it work and how does it help these patients?
No, in fact, the doses have to be increased because the mainstay of therapy is steroids. And steroid actually increases the blood sugars. And therefore, we just have to put them on insulin. Many patients, we have to put them on insulin. Now, in case the only basis where it decreases is this, that in the initial few days, so in COVID, in the initial 2-3 days, the appetite goes down. And most people, after that, the appetite is normal. So when the appetite goes down, people eat less and therefore the blood sugar goes down. That's the only basis. Otherwise, we have to continue the oral and anti-diabetic the way it is. After 2-3 days, the appetite becomes normal. Nothing happens to the appetite. Even in a very severe case, you will find patient requiring 40 liters of oxygen and they may ask for chicken also to have. And we don't stop them. COVID diet is normal diet. In fact, it should be a good nutritious diet. So general concept was what? Till now, you must have heard, ki bimar ho gaya toh soft diet do. But that is not there in COVID at all. Okay? Bimar ho gaya toh, you don't give soft diet. You give absolutely normal diet, except when the appetite has gone down in the first 2-3-4 days, that's when you give a soft diet. And on the other extreme, if somebody is on ventilator, then the person cannot obviously eat. Then you have to give a rice to feeding and something like that. In between the entire spectrum, the diet is normal. In fact, you know, veg, non-veg, whatever the cultural preference, we give them. We don't stop anything. Full diet is what we give. And the diabetic doses, we don't decrease actually. It almost remains the same. But if those symptomatic people who have to be given steroids will increase the sugars. And therefore, you have to either up titrate the dose or you have to give insulin. In fact, non-diabetics, when you give steroids, their sugar increases. You have to give either some oral anti-diabetic drug or you give insulin. That's also a very big thing that PharmDs have to regulate, you know, because we might start with once a day solumedrol, let's say, or Dexa 4 milligram in the morning once a day, and the sugar might go up till 180, and we give 8 units of insulin. Next day, the COVID worsens, and you might make 4 milligram twice a day or 40 milligram solumedrol twice or thrice a day. And the sugars will shoot up. So you girls have to see that, whether the doses have been adjusted properly, whether the OHAs have been given properly. So all that is important. And then when the patient recovers, the steroid dose starts coming down, you have to down regulate the insulin doses and probably down regulate the oral diabetic drugs also. Okay, so diabetic drugs do not decrease in COVID. Mostly it increases.
Okay, sir. So there's one more question. There has been mentioned for the patients to follow sick day guidelines. Please explain about it, sir.
Strict what guidelines?
Sick day guidelines.
I didn't get you. Sick day.
S-I-C-K.
Yes.
Sick day guidelines.
Yes, sir.
What is that? Who gave that guidelines? I'm not really aware of it.
So actually, well, it's a question from YouTube, sir. So,
yeah.
No. Why sick day guidelines? I didn't understand the question. So whoever is asked, can he or she elaborate? I can't see that.
So they might. The question is from YouTube, if, so they couldn't. If is there anyone to explain about it? So please do it.
Okay.
Go to the next question, sir.
Yeah, go to the next question because I'm not aware of any sick day guidelines like that. And I don't like to call people sick, you know, it makes them more sick. We try to boost them up and cheer them up. We just try to tell them to follow because psychologically they are extremely stressed out. So you will see if at all you enter the COVID ward, you will keep seeing me chatting and joking and making the patients laugh and all those things. In fact, most of the instructions we have already given on video rounds. We take video rounds. The RMO goes with a video call, something like a WhatsApp video, and I've already given all the instructions. And the patients we meet only to boost them up, cheer them up, educate them, allay their fears, allay their anxiety and all that. So that's what we do, and we don't call them sick. We try to really, because there is some basis that people who get totally psychologically stressed, they get much worse cytokine storm. Okay? That cytokine storm can get worsened because of psychological stress. That is, it's not a very sound thing, no proven thing on that. But, you know, let's assume that there's some basis for it. And that's why we try to keep them in very high spirits. Okay? Yeah, next.
So the next question is, how are blood pressure drug doses adjusted in COVID patients?
So again, COVID, one, there is dehydration, BP can drop, but two, steroids, BP can increase. And three, stress, BP can increase. So you have to regulate it properly and accordingly, you have to titrate the BP medication. That's what it is. Means we continue the previous BP medication if somebody has a BP and we just titrate it based on all these factors. You know, steroids might temporarily worsen the blood pressure. So you have to up titrate it. And when they recover, you again down titrate it. So that's how we do.
Okay. So the next question, sir, if you have time, we can continue.
I enjoy all this. If you are bored, you stop.
No, sir, there are many questions from audience also. I'll take up then, sir.
Yeah, then fine. Please.
Reinfection is common with coronavirus, causing common cold, but not with SARS and MERS. But still, plasma therapy is known to cause reinfection. So is COVID-19 associated with reinfection?
So when we give plasma therapy, let's say we have given plasma therapy, that means we are bringing in outside antibodies and we are destroying the virus that is in the patient's body, right? So we are not allowing the patient's immune system to respond adequately to the virus. Got it? The patient's immune system has not responded adequately to the virus, which means that the virus got recovered because of external antibody. That means my body has still not recognized that virus. So if the person theoretically gets again a throat, coronavirus comes in, the patient will again get a reinfection. So that's the, a shortcoming, postulated shortcoming of plasma therapy. But reinfections occur. Unfortunately, COVID is also causing reinfection now. And why? Because the viral nucleotide sequence keeps on changing. So when it goes from one person to next to next to next, the person has fought the virus is fighting the person. In doing so, when the virus keeps on going from one generation to next of infection, there is some changes which occurs in the virus. So I'll tell you about one case where, reported, I think, from Belgium, or is it Korea, one of the two countries. So there, what they do that, if 100 patients are infected, at least 10 patients, they do a nucleotide sequencing of the virus also, right? So when you do a nucleotide sequencing, so in one particular patient who got reinfected, they had the nucleotide sequence of the previous infection, and they did the nucleotide sequence again, and they found that 29 nucleotides were different, the previous virus and the current virus. And that means that even 29 nucleotides, if it changes, the body will be unable to recognize the virus, and you will get one more COVID infection. Now, most of the time, the second infection is milder than the first infection. But one of the cases which was reported, the second infection was more severe than the first infection. So in the coming days, anything will happen. And in India, because of the scale of infection and the scale of our population, we don't know what kind of genetic changes the virus will undergo. If the genetic changes become favorable, the virus may just disappear, it just goes away, just like SARS-CoV-1. One fine day, SARS-CoV-1 went away. It just disappeared. So we are just hoping that something like this should happen with SARS-CoV-2. But genetic change would be such that it just disappears. Or the likely scenario is that it might be weakened, but the danger is that the nucleotide sequencing will keep on causing reinfections again and again. So that is what it is.
Okay.
Any more? You look tired.
No,
so we'll just stop.
I wanted to ask the one.
So there's one more question.
Bolo.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
Yes, sir. Can MMR vaccine be given? Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Vaccine given through enema, you mean?
No. So, can MMR vaccine be given prophylactically, even in geriatrics? Like, is it possible?
Is it related to COVID? Prophylaxis for COVID? It will not work. It doesn't have any basis. Those are just some postulates which has been floated around, But it is not going to work. Mumps, measles vaccine will not work in this situation. We saw all this theory, right? We saw all this theory. Based on this theory, do you think that it will work? Do you think pneumovax will work in this situation? Do you think influenza vaccine will work? Do you think MMR will work? Do you think BCG will work? It's totally different. How many antibodies is our body producing? Millions and millions of types of antibodies bodies is producing, and they are all specific. So we've got this thymus gland, which disappears by the age of 15. So the thymus gland recognizes new antigen. That is why children are very efficient in recognizing this new antigen and producing a robust antibody response, because they've got thymus. As we age, thymus goes away. 15-16 saal, thymus is gone. So 18, 20, 22, 25, the ability to recognize the new antigen keeps on decreasing. And these are very specific, iska antibody, it's like iska chavi isme lagega kya? It's like saying MMR ka key, aapka ghar ka key mein lagega kya karke. It may not, or by fluke it may, right? But chances kitna hai? By fluke, one chavi might work here. How much is the chance? You know that 1 in 1,000, 1 in 5,000 chance. That's all it is. So all that thing, just forget. This is the theory behind vaccination and all. This is what we need to know, and cautious. cautious about what kind of vaccine is coming in and what should be done. What I feel is that, we saw DNA vaccine, RNA vaccine, protein-based vaccine. I feel COVID is going to require 2-3 types of vaccine, alag-alag type, different type of vaccine. Suppose 3 different vaccines are coming, each of them claiming that we neutralize this segment, glycoprotein. This one is neutralizing this glycoprotein. This one is utilizing this glycoprotein or RNA. So why not give all 3 at intervals? That kind of a thing will have the most effective thing. Why that is not being talked about? Why that is not being talked about? Because Abbott is producing only one vaccine, Eli Lilly another. So Abbott is not going to say, along with my vaccine, take Eli Lilly vaccine also. So because of that commercial thing, people are not postulating this, that you will have to take multiple vaccines of different types. Now, do we take multiple vaccines? Yes, rabies, we have to take 5 vaccines, right? Rabies, we take 5 vaccines, but 5 same vaccine. Okay, we have to come to a thing which I feel, which will work, is that you have to take 2 or 3 different type of vaccines, maybe at intervals, 1 week, 1 week, 1 week. And that might give you the best chance of producing a robust immune response, that if the virus comes, if this glycoprotein is working, this will work, otherwise this will work, otherwise this will work, and the virus will get neutralized. That's how it is. So yeah, MMR and all will not really work. From the theory that we have discussed, it doesn't work. Okay?
Yes, sir. So a very last question now. Okay. It's in thousands of people's mind that is steam inhalation the best remedy, which is an ongoing trend, we can say. Any reason why we are using this technique and how it is beneficial?
So steam is water vapor, right? So 1 ml of water vapor has 540 calories. That's physics, okay? And so when we take steam, we are, sending in a few ml of water. Each ml has got 540 calories. This is my nasopharynx. And here it is full of virus. Okay? And that 540 calories is, getting absorbed here. And that heat can kill the virus. Right? That heat, the throat has made a lot of secretions. So that steam, water, and that heat will melt all that secretions. Those secretions have billions and billions of virus. Okay? So that steam will be able to either kill the virus, or we can cough out and we can expectorate and we can, remove the virus. But will you remove 100% of the virus? It won't get removed. 100% aap nahi nikal sakte ho. Secondly, is the virus only on the surface? It has gone inside the cells and it's gone inside further and further inside the cells. Will the heat go right up till there? It will not go. The best team can do is decrease the viral load in your throat. But the COVID virus rapidly enters the lungs. By the time you are symptomatic, you are getting a throat infection. Many of them, it has already gone in the lungs. And therefore, will the steam remove the lungs ka virus? It will not. Max, it will reach up till the upper end of the trachea. That's all. Therefore, steam is good because it will, kill some of the virus, might theoretically decrease the viral load, and might remove the thick secretions also, and it might help. So there's a video of some yoga technique. You put water and you've seen all that, no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, that causes more sinusitis than it removes the virus, huh? By putting that water inside, you get sinusitis. So I have had people who have done that and come with me with sinusitis as a preventive. So you have to be very rational. about all these things. So steam has some basis, but it's not a magic. Yes, do I recommend? I do recommend. But we used to always, even for common cold, we recommend steam. Why do we recommend steam? For the same reason. It is going to remove the thick phlegm. It is going to decrease the viral load. And the heat stimulates blood flow also. The heat in the throat stimulates blood flow. So it helps the WBCs to come and attack the virus also. So it's a good thing, but it's not 100% effective. Doesn't remove 100% virus.
Okay. Okay. Sir. Yes, sir. Sir, again a small question, sir.
Okay. Okay. So I'll give small answer.
After recovery from corona, what precautions a patient needs to take in order to prevent the recurrence?
Okay. So the patient has to take the same precautions.
The disease.
Yeah, I got the question, although voice was breaking. The patient has to take the same precautions as he was taking first time. That is physical distancing, face masks, sanitizers, everything. All the precautions he has to still take. Because, for some time, the virus will not multiply in the throat of the recovered patient. Okay? If the virus goes in my throat and I have recovered from COVID, it is not going to multiply here. So when I speak, I will not transmit COVID. Understood?
Yes.
Right? But if I touch my hands here and there, and I come and shake hands with you, I will transmit COVID to you. So the person who has recovered from COVID will not give COVID to others from his mouth, aerosols from his mouth, but with his fomites, touching he can give, he or she can give. Secondly, he can get infected. If I said 29, 30 nucleotides change, okay, a different virus enters in, he will still get a COVID infection. So for both this reason, the person still has to take the same precaution. So as he took the first time before he was getting the first COVID infection.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Here I declare the question and answer session over. I hand over the session to my mate, Yamini. For Thanksgiving. Over to you, Yamini.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to thank sir for giving his valuable time and deliver this session for the benefit of the students. Thank you, sir, for such an informative session. It provided us in-depth insights regarding the topic on how the virus infects us, its complications, diagnosis, management, and most importantly, the types of vaccines. We appreciate our participants' doubts being cleared, and we look forward to more of such knowledgeable sessions from you, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Bye. And then, all our participants for joining in for the session. We also hope to see you for our upcoming webinars. The registration links for the webinars are posted on the chat box, and the feedback link for this webinar is also posted in the chat box. We request you to kindly fill the same. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Bye. Bye.